This next song is a little thing that I concocted to answer a question that's been bothering jazz aficionados and jazz educators for years and years and years. At every one of the meetings of the jazz educators and where serious jazz fans get together, it doesn't take long before this question pops up. The question is this: why can't educated Englishmen sing the blues convincingly? And I have to fill you in on a little bit of the background. The English were very early jazz fans. They embraced the music, as in fact many European countries did, but the English in particular had some very good players, even in the 20s, and wrote very erudite pieces and had a rhythm magazine, which in the late 20s was talking about the Chicago rhythm and what this guy was playing on, what Eddie Lang was playing on a record, and they had transcribed Bix choruses and stuff. In that sense, they were ahead of us in America. And they had some wonderful jazz musicians over the years. One thinks of trumpeter Nat Ganella, and there was a guitar player, Albert Harris, and all the guys who played with Ray Noble on those records, and Lou Stone, and so forth. And then later on, of course, there's George Shearing, and quite a bunch of them. Of course, I haven't mentioned them all. And Malcolm Lowry, for example, in Under the Volcano, writes about, he plays the taro patch, a kind of a ukulele-like instrument, and he wants to have a band, and he wants to call it the Five Hot Cantabs, because that was for Cambridge. That's a slang word for Cambridge. And jazz was all over the place and very much appreciated. And they sent people over to the United States, Alastair Cook in the 30s, for example, to narrate shortwave broadcasts to London of American jam sessions and jazz events. So you'd think, why can't educated Englishmen, in particular, because they were the first to embrace the music, take it seriously, write articles, why can't they sing the blues convincingly? I was kicking this around, and I thought, I know what to do. The best way to probably answer this perplexing question is to write a song, demonstrate it with music. And I had this song together, and I had it all, I'd worked on it for weeks and weeks and weeks. I had it all in final form, but I couldn't get into it. I didn't know how to start the damn thing. I couldn't get an introduction going. And it perplexed me. I stayed up nights. I drank cups and cups of coffee. I tried everything. I researched. I listened to records. Nothing worked. Finally, I said, the hell with it. And I said, I'm going off to my annual vacation. And vacation I did indeed. And that year I was going to follow my other hobby. And that was to go to the annual convention of the Amateur Fig Pickers, of which I am an avid member. And that was going to be held in Smyrna, Turkey. So after crossing the ocean on a liner, I found myself on the Wagon Lit, going from Paris to Istanbul. And I went into the dining car, sat down and ordered my supper, had a glass of hock and seltzer, and an elderly gentleman came and was, as they do, they seat them opposite you, and he sat opposite me at the table, and we got talking. And I told them where were you going and what were you doing, that sort of thing. And I said I was going to the fig picking convention. And the idea of the fig picking convention, incidentally, which I forgot to mention, is that one of the rules of the Amateur Fig Pickers Association is that you can't shake the tree, rattle it, or bombard it, throw rocks at it or anything. The figs have to be so ripe that they fall of their own volition. And then what happens is that the amateur fig pickers who have telephone books, catalogs, I hate to mention it, but those Bibles that you find in hotels and motels, yes, they even do that. And they wait for that propitious moment when the fig drops of its own volition and clap it between the pages of this book. And then they wait about 4 or 6 months, and when it's dried, they peel the pages apart, and then the fig is suitable for mounting, and they have them in frames and then on the wall and so forth. So anyway, here we were going to this, and I had a wonderful collection of Mission figs, Kadota figs, Calamurna figs, Damascus figs, all these different varieties, Turkish figs, they're wonderful. And it was a pleasure. I have rooms lined with these figs in little frames, you know, and it does my heart good to just walk and look at them. And anyway, so I'm sitting opposite this gentleman, and we start talking about figs, and he asked me what I do, and I said, well, I'm a musician. And he said, oh, that's rather curious. I'm a musician as well, after a fashion. And I said, oh, well, that is interesting. And by this time, we were both drinking Hock and Seltzer and enjoying each other's company, talking about the figs and everything. He says, yes. And I said, oh, well, then I let me introduce myself. Have I heard of you, he said. And I said, well, I'm from America. I don't think you probably have. And he said, I introduced myself. No, he hadn't, sorry to say. He was very polite. And I said, may I have your name, sir? And he said, well, my name is Elgar. And I said, Elgar, you don't mean, you know, there's a composer named Edward Elgar. And I he said, yes, well, you wouldn't happen to be related to him. He was very reluctant. He finally said, yes, I am that man. And I said, oh, my goodness. I said, I was, you're the great Edward Elgar who wrote Pomp and Circumstance, which children all over America, millions of children have graduated to this song. Bom, 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 bom. I was just dumbstruck. Well, a few more glasses of Hock and Seltzer. The wagon lit rolled on through the night. We had yet again another order of Hock and Seltzer, and pretty soon it was Eddie and Marty, and as we conversed through the night, I told him my problem about it, and I said I was interested in jazz, and he said, oh yes, I'm quite interested in jazz music myself. I find it to be very refreshing and so forth. And anyway, and I told him my problem. I said, I got this piece, Mr. Elgar, that I've written, or I'm sorry, by that time it was Eddie. I've got this piece, Eddie, see? And I can't get an intro for it. And so he said, listen, how about if I take a crack? I'd love to do something like that. I so like your American jazz music. And I said, okay, gee, that'd be thrilled. Okay, I'm knocked out. Could you really? I thought in my head, my God, this would give the piece cachet. Introduction by Sir Edward Elgar. Holy moly. This is really going to put it over. And anyway, the night went on. The fig picking went on after the excursion to Istanbul and to around Turkey. I had a nice several suitcases full of wonderful figs between pages of catalogs and books and so forth. And I got back to the United States, and I thought, man, now I can solve this thing. I'll get this intro written, and this is great. You know, do, 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 do. I'm very happy. And I'm home about couple of weeks, and I pick up the New York Times, noted composer dies in London. Oh, no, sudden death, stroke, he had a stroke. Sir Edward Elgar, I said, oh, no, I'll never hear this intro. And he had written me a card before and said, have your introduction almost finished? Hope you like it when I send it to you. And that was the last I heard from him. I wrote, and I called, and I was going out of my head, and his family was very nice. The relatives and stuff were very friendly, and said they searched the house, and they searched. No, they couldn't find the introduction. Finally, I was beside myself. I was possessed, driven, and I took a steamer over, got off, went to London, looked up the family. They must have sensed my intensity of my need and my feeling for this thing, because after I talked to them for a while, they finally caved in, and the next thing you know, we were the family. It was nighttime in a corner churchyard in some place in London. There we were. It was dark. Slight drizzle was falling, and there was a bobby with a pocket torch and a couple of navvies with pick mattocks digging in the ground, and we were at the gravesite of the late Sir Edward Elgar in a gloomy old churchyard. And after about a couple of hours of digging, they finally got down, and I heard the dull thud of the pick mattocks as they struck the leaden lid of the coffin. And shortly thereafter, there was an eerie screech as the lid was pulled back. There I saw it, the remains, the mortal remains of the late Sir Edward Elgar, clutched in his bony hands. Written on an ordinary piece of foolscap was this introduction to the English blues, which I am now going to play for you.